you not to waste any more time. Let us give the new transportation ordinance some time to operate and see what happens. Let's give it a year or so before we revisit any changes that we may make. Uber needs Portsmouth more than we need them. We've existed before they did, and we will after they are gone. If they can't provide enough safety and liability for passengers in Portsmouth, I think we should say that they should not be allowed to operate. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. And the next speaker is Brendan Dubois.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Brendan Dubois. I'm a resident Rexter, the brother of the outgoing chief. I'm speaking on my own behalf. Those of us who visit your beautiful city have a stake in seeing your superb police department is overseen by a professional and competent civilian authority. However, the actions of the police commission this past Friday demonstrates the exact opposite. It's clear that two commissioners have previously met and decided, not violating the right to know law, to merely bring in former Manchester Chief Mara to Portsmouth. They blindsided two vendors who came in good faith to describe how they would secure an interim and permanent chief for the city. Instead, these vendors were told a decision had already been made before their arrival. The law enforcement community is a tight-knit one, and I guarantee that the rude, inconsiderate, and unprofessional treatment those two vendors received is now widely known. What experienced law enforcement official will not come here as a chief after seeing this kind of civilian oversight? According to the Herald, your city manager said, "I've never seen anything like this in my career." This council recently reviewed your city manager and gave him high marks. Assistant Mayor Splane was quoted saying he has served with seven different city managers, and Mr. Lehenko was among the best. This suggests that your city manager knows what he's talking about. Despite the vows of transparency and openness from Commissioners Kavanaugh and Nesko, the secretive way Chief Mayor was chosen was anything but. There was no professional assurance, there was no input from residents, nothing was done out in the open. The decision to bring in Chief Mayor was presented as a fait accompli. Supposedly, Commissioner Nesko spent some hours talking with Chief Mara before making this decision. That's it. Commissioner Kavanaugh said in an October Herald article she spoke to Chief Mayor because she served on the board and was noted his astounding professionalism. Yet Commissioner Kavanaugh didn't go far enough in detailing his personal relationship. Since 2008, the two of them have served together on the board of directors for the Manchester Police Association. The most recent IRS 990 form lists Commissioner Kavanaugh as its secretary. Ladies and gentlemen of the City Council, you know what Chief Mayor's selection represents. This wasn't a professional search done with due diligence. This was cronyism, plain and simple. He was chosen because of who he knows, not because of what he's done. How can you, the City Council, in good faith, act such cronyism? In her article in the Herald, Kavanaugh also stated, "I encourage all who read my letter to research Chief Mayor's background." I did just that, and a 5-minute check in Google revealed the story the two commissioners failed to mention. On March 3, 2010, four off-duty Manchester police officers nearly beat a man to death at a bar in Manchester. The resulting cover-up led to an investigation by the Attorney General's office. The Unilever reported, quote, "Police initially downplayed the matter, but eventually asked the Attorney General to look into the matter. After months of investigation, Attorney General Delaney concluded the four officers had not committed a crime, but said it was not the Manchester Police Department's finest hour. Later, Manchester paid that man a settlement of $200,000. Here's a photo of the injuries he received from those four officers under Chief Mara's command. Man, two of your commissioners want to serve as a transitional interim chief. Does the City Council really support this unprecedented decision? Overseeing a police organization with a multi-million-dollar budget requires a professional and competent approach. It's not attending a university capital meeting or organizing a wine tasting party. I urge the City Council to intervene in the situation before it gets worse and the public safety of Portsmouth and its visitors are negatively impacted. The clumsy amateurs on the commissioner are doing you a severe disservice." Thank you.
Thank you, Brendan. That concludes our public comment session. Thank you very much, everyone who spoke, for your comments. With that, we will move on. Consideration of our resolutions and ordinances. The first is a first reading amending zoning ordinance so that certain described property in Sagamore Grove Road be rezoned from waterfront business of UB to single residence B.
Thank you, Your Honor. If I might, if there's a motion on the floor, I'd ask the planning director to come down and give a summary of what the issue is and how we're proceeding.
Could I move? I recommend that we pass first reading. Sagamore Avenue, and it's for rezoning a portion of the existing parcel from another front business to single residence B. In my memo, I should say, also say that at the same time, the planning board is in the process of reviewing an application for a subdivision to create a lot that is identical to the area that's being proposed to be rezoned. You may recall that a couple of years ago, you rezoned six lots at the end of Sagamore Road from waterfront business to single residence B, and the proposed lot that is proposed to be rezoned is adjacent to those six lots. There's one minor change in what is presented to you tonight. The property owner had initially requested a 20,000 square foot lot to be created to be rezoned. Subsequently, working with the Division of Environmental Services, which has to approve the subdivision also because it's in the waterfront area, it was increased to 24,000 square feet, which is what the planning board voted on. And then since then, last week, last Thursday, the applicant submitted a revised plan that increases the lot area to 25,678 square feet. So if you move forward with this, it would be appropriate to change the date of the revision plan from what I've stated is October 9th, 2015 to November 6th, 2015, to change the area proposed to be zoning from 24,000 square feet to 25,678 square feet.
Questions? Council Spear and then Council Morgan.
So I'd like to, and then I'll defer to the planning board, having done the research on this. My only hesitation is part of the sense of community we have is to protect our maritime culture, maritime businesses. And in fact, even a privately owned business has some modicum of public access, you know, because business often wants a couple of people to come in and work with the business on the water. And as we transition away from maritime business into residential, you begin to lose some of that public access to water and maritime culture. So how does, I don't know if we've done this in the past, as you mentioned in your memo, did the planning board wrestle with that at all, and what's their thinking in terms of the long-term vision for the world?
Yeah, so I'd like to say that the waterfront business district has been a struggle wherever it exists. So it's a very small district that exists down on the waterfront on Caddy Street in that area, and it exists right in this area on both sides of Sagamore Creek. In this particular case, the area that is proposed to be set off and rezoned is does not go down to the water. So they've actually defined a lot that does not go down to the water. There's actually quite a sharp, steep drop off from the lot to the water. So it's really not really appropriate for waterfront use. The remainder of the lot, which actually wraps around the proposed rezoning, maintains all of the current lot's waterfront and all of the area that is low enough to be really useful for waterfront business.
Council Morgan and Council Thurston.
Could you just recap the timeline of what was the number of the size of the lot?
Well, yeah, sure. Well, initially, the initial proposal was to be around 20,000 square feet. I don't know the exact number. It's just about 20,000 square feet. And because this is in the 100-foot setback from Sagamore Creek, and because the owner proposes to use the septic system, the Department of Environmental Services also has to approve the subdivision. And in the initial round, it appeared that DES would approve a 24,000 square foot lot, which was presented to the planning board. The planning board voted on and is recommended by memo to you. But just last week, I guess the final approval by DES said it had to go up to 25,678 square feet in order to be approved by DES. So it's the net effect is about it's moving the lot line about 11 feet closer to the water. It's really a really enormous change.
Yeah, I was just going to reaffirm, came on the planning board, we did have a discussion in answer to the Councilor Spear's question. had the discussion specifically talked about whether it was feasible or not for this property to ever develop into a waterfront business. And the answer that came back really was no, the land is just, it can't be reworked. You know, it's rocky with edge. You'd have to, it's a very narrow strip actually that goes by the waterside itself, and the rest of the land is all behind its ledge. So I just wanted to reaffirm that you did talk about it at great length and decided that it was really not feasible zone the way it was. It was just going to sit there for a long time.
Anyone else? Okay, if not, we have a round of motions. Okay, Councilor Kennedy?
Yes, I guess I'd like to ask the planning, instead of planning, what happens when the community is giving up their commercial waterfront?
Did I say this?
Yeah.
You repeated that.
What happens when communities give up their waterfront?
Well,
the waterfront.
Yes, in this case, that is an issue in these other waterfront business districts. And we struggle with that primarily in the central down near Mechanic Street in that area. In this case, we're preserving all of the waterfront that's in the waterfront. I mean, all of the actual waterfront in the waterfront business district, the portion of the lot that is being proposed to be set off and proposed to be rezoned, is actually set back from the waterfront. So, and does not appear to be usable as waterfront business.
Councilor Kennedy, anyone else?
We do have, Mr. Kennedy, just to make sure that when we get the second reading, we get the second reading of the public hearing, the public and the council have the amended ordinance in front of them. Could you please give us again the new revision date and the new square footage and
the last of the new revision date, which is written as 10/9/15, would become 11/6/15. And the area, which is shown as 24,000 square feet, would become 25,617 square feet.
Thank you. And that's where we'll advertise it. Well, I thought at some point we should ask the council to make it.
Tonight.
Actually, if Your Honor, the council wishes to make an amendment right now, we will move those amendments.
So I'd like to move that amendment.
So move.
Motion seconded. Okay, on the side of the roll call vote, please.
Mayor Swain?
Yes.
Councilor Sheen?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
No.
You say no?
Yes.
You say no? Sorry. Councilor Lana?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Morgan?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Thorson?
Yes.
Mayor Lister?
Yes. Okay, thank you. So next, roll call vote for that as well, please.
Assistant Mayor Swain?
Yes.
Councilor Shaheen?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
What was the motion?
This is the main motion as amended.
No.
Councilor Lamb?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Morgan?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Thorson?
Yes.
Mayor Lister?
Yes. Next, we have B, first reading amending zoning ordinance chapter 10, section 10.1530, term of general applicability, amend the definitions of hotel and motels as follows: shall not include casino gambling, keno, or other games of chance.
Just a very minor amendment, just to clarify that.
Thank you.
anyway, but is other, is games of chance defined in our ordinances in some way? So
no, it is not.
Okay, so this means, I assume, again, not that I'm thrilled about it, but that if a local group wanted to have a bingo game in a hotel or motel, this would prevent that. Is that correct?
Correct.
So I just want to make sure, because games of chance could mean, it doesn't have to mean money, gambling, or anything like that. It could just mean an activity of some type. So I'm not sure. I mean, at second reading, we can look at that. But, you know, I'm certainly in favor of the outline of casino gambling and the keno, but I'm wondering if we're taking this a little too far for, you know, a church activity or something.
Could I move to suspend the rules and take up item 11C, the Uber issue, since I think some people have some interest in that?
Second? Second? Okay, roll call vote, please.
Councilor Gasparini?
Yes.
Councilor Shaheen?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Lyon?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Morgan?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Thorson?
Yes.
Mayor Lister?
Yes. Thank you. Assistant Mayor Swain.
I would like to explain it after I make the motion. I move to authorize the city attorney to prepare an ordinance for first reading at the summer 7, 2015 city council meeting that includes the technical amendments to the transportation services ordinance that have been requested by Uber in its letter of October 19, 2015.
I'm
not sure how I would vote on the technical changes or the changes requested by Uber, but Uber, an Uber representative did go to this chamber to the October meeting of the Transportation Services Committee, and we had a dialogue for about 45 minutes about some of the, about the three specific changes, I think, that they wanted to have us take a look at. I think it would only be responsible that we have an opportunity at the city council table before this this confusion that we're facing right now in the city goes on any longer to consider those changes and whether or not they are things that the city council would want to make any movements. The fact is that Uber was illegal under our previous ordinance. We allowed a grace period while the city council considered an adjustment to that ordinance, which had been 12.5 pages and had been in effect for many years. There was a system of 28 medallions, which means that only 28 cabs were allowed in Portsmouth, so ride shares could not operate at all. The new ordinance that took effect September 17th was an effort to allow ride shares to be able to operate in Portsmouth, to allow any independent, anybody else, to be able to operate. We eliminated the medallion system and substantially reduced the process for applying so that people could apply and operate a taxi cab or participate in ride sharing. But because of the ordinance carrying over the same requirements that we had previously on background checks and insurance coverage, virtually verbatim in wording, Uber feels that the